Hello students, in the previous class of class 9th of chapter Is Matters Around Us Pure, we had discussed about the some methods to separate components from mixture. Today we'll discuss some remaining methods also. These are distillation, fractional distillation, crystallization. So let's see distillation at first. The basic concept behind these two are that whatever is liquid, is if there is mixture of liquid, then their boiling point doesn't change, as it is the physical characteristic of any liquid, and the mixture is in having physical change, so there is no change in boiling point. Then what we do here, it is used, these two methods are used for the miscible liquids. Miscible liquids. Before this, we had discussed about the immiscible liquids using the separating funnel. We had separated the immiscible liquid like oil and water, but today we'll see how we can separate the miscible liquids with each other. For example, acetone and water. How we'll separate it? The thing which we should consider for using distillation is that the difference in their boiling point should be considerable, at least 25 degree there should be the difference. So the gradient or difference, gradient and boiling point should be high so that we can choose it. Okay. Now what they do here, there is a special setup for this. Here it is a distillation flask. Okay, this solar put on stand. Here it is a knob having thermometer. Then there is an outlet. From this outlet, there is a tube going through this with a condenser, and then this hole will and this whole setup here is on. It's a tripod, and then it will be sticking. Okay. What we do, we take how we just deal this distillation process. In this distillation flask, we keep our mixture. Then there is a thermometer which help to measure the temperature. There it is a condenser, and there is a inlet of cold water, and there is outlet of So let's see what is the use of this. When there this mixture is going to increase, we are providing heat energy here. By this heat, the temperature of this mixture increases, and as I have told you that there should be the large difference in their boiling point, the liquid with low boiling point start evaporating first, and it will reach here. And as there is only passage, so it will go here. And there is a condenser, it is a glass tube having the inlet of cold water, the cold water running through this system. And this cold water will cause the cooling of that vapor, so that this vapor phase, which is the liquid which is in gaseous phase, will turn into the liquid. So it help, it is known as a condense. It helps to condense the your that gas. Or then the mixture which is of low boiling point. At first, low boiling point will turn into vapor, will go through condenser and will again turn into liquid, and we will collect it here in your or any container you will collect it with. In this way we are able to until that this mixture, this one which is having the low, high boiling point did not increase up to this level, will be here as it is. So it was about the distillation process in which we can separate the miscible liquids of having boiling point difference between 25 or more than 25 degrees. Then let's see what is the fractional distillation. You can imagine that although we are increasing the temperature, there is boiling point difference and the liquid with the low boiling point will go there. But along with this, the vaporization is also takes place. So some amount of another liquid may also go through this. And there is a shortcoming or limitation that there we need a difference in boiling point, great difference in boiling point. But if you are having the liquids with or the mixture of liquids with a very little a slight difference in boiling point, then what we do, we will go for the fractional distillation. So let's see what is the fractional distillation. And fractional distillation in comparison to this is more efficient distillation method. Although in senior classes you will see there are other type of distillation like steam distillation method, like vacuum distillation method. But here we will discuss only two, the simple distillation method which I have told you. And to make it more efficient, we go for the fractional distillation method. And there is one advantage that the boiling point difference is very slight difference here. And we can use with the miscible liquid. Miscible liquid. It is more efficient process. Now let's see how it is more efficient. We do nothing, there is same setup except we are adding one more column here, that is your fractional column. Here we use a fractional column having so many glass beads. This fractional column having many glass beads and except it, everything is same as in distillation method. It was your thermometer. So now let's see how does it work. The concept is same, the lower boiling point, a liquid will go upward and it will condense here, we will collect it from here. But here we are adding the fractional column. How it works? Actually, this fractional column is having some glass beads, full of glass beads, or we can use some ceramics also. What it was and how it make it more efficient. When the liquid vaporizes here, the vapors come in contact with this. And as it go here, before this to be, before reaching this outlet, it comes in contact with these beads, and we are increasing the number of beads so that these beads increase the surface area and surface area of contact of liquid or vapor, we should say. Vapor which is going to reach here. When it come in contact with this, it again condenses. And it condenses. Okay. and go back to the distillation flask. Go back to distillation flask and again come as a vapor. So as there is this process is repeated again and again to reach here. Due to this, the impurities or the mixture will come down and only the liquid which is of particular boiling point or higher boiling point will reach at first here with so much of purity. So this method becomes very efficient. So now we can get that what is the role of fractional column. Fractional column having the glass beads or ceramics increase the surface area of contact of vapor which is going upward to condense and to form the liquid. And as it comes in contact with these beads, it again condenses as its temperature downs. At the time of reaching here, it comes in contact with these beads and its temperature down, it condenses here and go back to the distillation flask. And again, its temperature increases again, it comes here. This process of condensing here is condensing of mixture, I should say, is here repeated. So finally, the liquid we get here is more pure liquid. In this way, you see that this fractional distillation becomes very important. And this fractional distillation we use to separate the mixture of air. So let's see how the mixture of gases, or we call this air, we can separate its component by using the fractional distillation process. Because the temperature difference between the major gases, I should say the oxygen, argon and nitrogen, it is minus 96. So here you can just see oxygen, argon, nitrogen, it is minus 96, it is minus 186, it is minus 196. So the boiling point of which is lower, it is lower, so we will get it at first, then at second we will get it, and finally we will get the oxygen, which is having comparatively the more boiling or high boiling point. Now let's see how do we use this fractional distillation method for the separating these components. For this, I am providing you a flow chart, and you can go through this page of NCERT, which is having a very nice presentation with the help of diagram. You can see at the page number 23 it is. But here I will just make the flow chart to make your concept more clear. So let's see how we just do. First, it is your mix. To save our time, we just draw this flowchart here. What we do at first, there is a air mixture of gases. At first, we filter it. To go in fractional distillation, what is very important thing is that it should be liquid and which is miscible liquid. So we have to convert these gases into the liquid form. How we can convert it? In the conversion of states of matters, in my previous class, YouTube class, what we have seen, we need a high pressure and low temperature. So for fractional distillation, we will provide this situation so that the gases will turn into liquid state and it will go through the distillation. So let's see how the air will at first pass through the filter. We filter it so that the dust particle will not be here. Then the filtered air will provide the high pressure, and at the high pressure and at it is at hot air, so this high pressure hot air, this then the second condition, we had fulfilled the first one, we had provided the high pressure. Now we need to down its temperature. What we do, this hot air will go for the cooling. How do this? There is a container through which it will pass in this way, but the surrounding medium is having the cold water. This cold, it is the inlet of cold water. It will go through this, it will cover the whole system, and as it will become hot, it will go out, and this cycle is continuously going on and on, so that the hot air, temperature of hot air will reduce. Now we'll get the cold compressed air. Okay, cold compressed air we can get, as it is cold, so we can, from here we can get the dry ice or carbon dioxide before turning it into liquid. So we use a separator and we just separate the carbon dioxide, which is at very low temperature, known as your dry ice. We call it dry ice because its temperature is very low, but it is not wet. So we call it dry ice. Dry means it is not wet. We don't feel the wetness here, but it is having the same, it is having the very cool or freezing temperature. So we can separate the carbon dioxide here. Now the remaining gas will turn into liquid air because of that high pressure and low temperature. Now this liquid air will go to the fractional distillation. The same apparatus is using that distillation flask with fractional column with thermometer and then condenser. And on the basis of the boiling point, at first we'll get the liquid nitrogen, and then we'll get the argon gas, which is having -186 degrees, and finally the remaining 21% of oxygen will get here. Okay, it was all about the fractional distillation and the major use of fractional distillation, in which we are separating the mixture of gases from the air. Now the last methods of separation, which is crystallization, let's discuss this also. So the final method of separation is the crystallization method. Before dealing this crystallization method, I will make your concept clear that in case of vaporization, or when we were separating the mixture or components which were volatile and not volatile, what we do, there was a vaporization, or we evaporate the volatile substance and the remaining was a non-volatile, we separate. Here is the method of crystallization. What we, it is much better than filtration and vaporization method. How it is, let's see. In this we it is very important in formation of or getting salt from sea, even in formation of snowflakes you will see it is okay, and very important in case of you will get the crystals of sugar in honey. This is also the example of your crystallization of sugar and honey jar. We will also, how it is done, let's see. Actually, when a solution having the mixture of a soluble solute, and we are supposed to separate it, there is one method that we evaporate all liquid or all water from this and we get the solute. But this method may hamper your solute, because when you see the sugar, In case of this sugar, what happened? It may char because of hot or heat. Hot temperature, it may char, means it may turn into the carbon, only carbonic acid, carbonic compounds. So these carbon compounds are not of us use. So what we do, this method of crystallization we do, how it works, let's see. At first, this solution, we provide the heat, or due to heat, some solvent will evaporate and from here it is very important. And now this solution we have to turn into saturated solution. Saturated solution. And little more will provide heat and finally will turn it into the super saturated solution. What is the meaning of super saturated solution? In the topic of this, in part 2, I have told you. Saturated means the solute is dissolved at its maximum level. But I am talking about super saturated means either we are increasing the temperature, but the solvent is not that much efficient to dissolve any solute in this. So now it is super saturated. For this, we also add some agents in this solution, or ions in this solution, which is known as a saturating agent. And then we provide the cooling here. Okay. So in crystallization, what we see, the solution, little bit of solvent we had evaporated so that it becomes super saturated. For making it super saturated, we also add some super saturating agent in this, and then this whole solution will go into cooling. This cooling help to form the, or help in crystallization, means the solute will form, whatever the solute is here, solute will turn into the crystal. This crystal is very important structure. Okay, we'll see the amorphous and crystal, we'll see it later. But this solute will form a particular organized structure known as crystal. So this whole and this crystal is pure form without having any impurity. In case of vaporization, what we do? Either just increasing the temperature, the volatile substance was turned into gas. The substance which left was a mixture of other solutes. But here the crystal which we are obtaining is of particular solute, so it is very pure form. So now you can see this crystallization is much better to use in comparison to that vaporization and filtration process. So it was all about your separating methods, various separating methods of component from the mixture. I hope this will help you to understand. Let's see another topic which is very little, and I know that you are much aware about this topic, but it is present in your class. So let's discuss. There is a very minute difference which we should consider between the physical change and chemical changes. Chemical changes. In case of physical changes or physical reaction, we used to say that it is irreversible, and chemical changes irreversible, physical changes reversible. The major difference between these is, in case of physical change, only the physical properties changes. Physical property change or physical characteristic change occur. In case of chemical change means anything or any substance goes under the chemical reaction, and after the chemical reaction always there is formation of new substance having the new chemical properties. So in case of we used to say that irreversible, obviously it is irreversible, but what actually happens here, there is a chemical reaction, and due to this, whatever the reactant we are taking, it will turn into the product, and their properties of reactant product is totally different. Their chemical properties are characteristic different than the substance from where it is formed. Okay, there are many examples in your book. Let's discuss what are these. Let me see what are these methods. For example, cutting of tree, it is physical change. Melting of butter in pan, it is also physical change. Rusting of almira, as it is made up of iron and it turn into the ferric oxide, and so it is your chemical change. Then the boiling of water to form steam, as there is only the state conversion, so it is physical change. Passing of electric current through water and the water breaking into hydrogen and oxygen. As the water breaks into hydrogen and oxygen, so hydrogen and oxygen are not similar to the H2O, and there is a chemical reaction takes place, so it is a chemical change. Then dissolving common salt into water, where even we have separated it with the help of crystallization. I told you that we separate the sea salt from the seawater. It was physical change. Then making of fruit slab with raw fruit, it is also the physical change. No change in their state, as after cutting the same taste, same product, but even the shape is going to change. So it is a physical. Burning of paper and wood, what is it? It is a chemical change. One more. Let me see what is present in your exercise. There are some. Yes, growth of plant, it is irreversible because there are so many biochemical reaction takes place. So it is chemical change. Rusting of iron, I have told you earlier that it is chemical change. Mixing of iron filling in sand. Iron filling in sand, we can separate it with the help of magnet. The magnet will attract all the iron filling. Iron filling means the powder of iron. Iron will attract it toward the magnet. So it can separate. It can be separated from the physical method. So it is the physical change. Cooking of food, it is totally the chemical change. Digestion of food, we have even discussed that HCl release from the stomach, it turns, it help in converting the proteins into the protein products, or help in digestion of protein. So it is the chemical change. Then freezing of water, state change only, so it is the physical change. Burning of candle, it is also the chemical change. And it was all about the physical and chemical change, that in case of the physical change, only physical property changes. In case of the chemical reaction, a chemical change, these are the similar terms. There is only chemical property change. It means the chemical property change, the product we form, we get, is totally different from the reactant. So it was all about this chapter, is matter around us pure. I hope it will help you to make your concept building. Still, if you have any doubt, any query, drop your comment or drop your query in comment box. Thank you very much.